I am your host, Tabaka Ncube. Informal traders are up in arms with the government over plans to remove them from Harare's Central Business District ahead of the August SADC summit. The government says that this is to enhance the city's image during the summit. On the other hand, vendors, most of them young people, say this is tampering with their livelihoods. To discuss this issue, we are joined on the program by a street vendor, Mr. Ishe Kwenda, and ZANU-PF youth Snowball Tongokara. Welcome to the program, gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
We'll start with you, Mr. Kwenda. As vendors, what's your take on this move by the government?
To say that the idea is not that good, given that it's always good to keep our streets clean. But we cannot run away from the fact that people are on the streets not because they are interested more, they choose to be on the streets willingly, but it's because of the economic situation and the hardship, the poverty, the high rate of unemployment in the country. And if you look at the quarterly informal economic survey, the World Economics, it said that 64.7% of the economy is informal, that is the economy of Zimbabwe. So, and it is noted that these informal traders actually contribute more to the GDP of the country. So the street vendors are not excluded from this group. And to just change them away without a solid plan, I think it's not that good. For now, I think I'll just mention that.
Thank you, Mr. Kwenda. Mr. Tongokara, what's your take on this issue?
We welcome the government and government. We know that it's always been reminding them that we should be put up their business. And this is not the first time government.
Vatongokara, musiku nzwika musha menoti chii chiri kuitika nenhare yenyu. Regai tiedze kukufonerai zvekare tione kuti tinokubatai mava kunzwika zviri nani. Mr. Kwenda, we understand you talked about the issue of unemployment and a sustainable plan. What do you think is a plan that will be sustainable for Harare? Looking at that, this issue has been a problem for a very long time, and people have tried to be accommodated in different markets. Asi zviri kuramba kushanda. Ndezvipi zvamuri kuona kunge zvinogona kubatsira, zvichibatsira mativi ese ari maviri, divi rekuti Harare inge ichichena, uyezve divi rekuti vari kutengesa mumigwagwa vawanewo pekutengesera pakanaka, panouya zvekare vanhu vanotenga.
Okay, okay, thank you. What I think is that this problem cannot be solved overnight, and I think the government and all other stakeholders that are involved should have addressed this problem long ago. Firstly, the issue of transparency in the allocation of vending spaces is a big problem that is stopping or that is preventing sustaining the way of vending in Zimbabwe. Because we have a situation where we have a lot of people who are not vendors, who are not informal traders. They get a lot of vending spaces and they start to rent them out to the informal traders. I think if we are to start by allocating vending spaces to informal traders in a transparent way, that will be a very, very sustainable way. Think about the Blower Vendors and Traders Association, the DVTA, and the Vendors Initiative for Social and Economic Transformation. They've been engaging the government, they've been engaging all stakeholders, including vendors, on and coming up with a solid plan to deal with this problem. But it seems as if the solution is that the authorities are not willing to deal with the problem in a more sustainable way. I don't know the reason, but I think if we start to address that, the problem by transparent in allocation of land. Allocation of any spaces. Then we get all the usual bugs whenever we try to allocate any spaces to our internal tables. That way we can come up with, a sustainable informal economy in our country.
Thank you, Mr. Kwenda. We understand Mr. Tongokara is back on the line. Mr. Tongokara, you were still trying to make your point there. You can continue.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. You can continue, Mr. Tongokara.
Okay, thank you. As I was saying, we welcome the development by the government to move away vendors from the streets during the SODEX summit. And as a point, we need to also acknowledge that this is not the first time government has been telling vendors to operate at the designated areas. So we can't blame our government for trying to enforce a clean environment during the summit. And as you may be aware that every day, vendors and street counters, they play hating the mouse game. They chase against each other in town every day. And we can't expect such a kind of behavior to happen during the time of SADC. Even before this SADC or after SADC, our town CBD need to be clean. So our vendors must understand the position of government that we have a dignitaries from referring the country, and we're expecting more than 5,000 business delegates who are coming across the continent who will be in Harare. So we can be seeing many people are feeling their tomatoes, avocados, drinks, and so forth. So I think in that time, it's not really to understand the position of government, that this is a very important summit, not only for government officials, but even for vendors themselves. Government supports the vendors, and I think the government is also trying to encourage vendors to formalize their operation. They need to operate at designated places, and government understand their plight, but they also need to understand the position of government in this regard.
Thank you, Mr. Tongokara. Yekulo omunyongenileyo esecingweni laphana lisiyalamukela kuhlelo Sibanda. Hello. Yes, siyakuzwa Sibanda, ungakhweza mbijana ilizwi lakho laphana, uzwakalela uphansi. Ungasipha umbono wakho laphana Sibanda.
Ngiyangizwa manje.
Yes, siyakuzwa baba. Ye ungaqhubeka Sibanda bese sikuzwa. Silahlekelwe laphana ngusibanda obezama ukuthi asixhume ecingweni vathongogara mangamuchitsanangura apho panyaya yekuti vanhu varofanira kunzwisisa kuti panodiwa kuti pange paine kurongeka mudhorobha reHarare. Naizvozvo hurumende haina kutanga nhasi kuti ibvise vanhu vari kutengesa mumigwagwa, asi pakubviswa kwavo pakamboitawo matambudziko akafanana neekuti panzvimbo dzakatarwa kuti vange vachishandira panga paine dambudziko rekuti vari kuti tawanda vari kutengesa nekuda kwekushaya mabasa, hatichakwane munzvimbo idzodzo. Poitwa sei apo pachienderera mberi vatongogara?
Thank you very much. Zimbabwe is a free country, and if you go in other countries, you cannot even be allowed to be a vendor and visit a vendor in CPT. But the government of Zimbabwe has been tolerating vendors because we understand the plight of our people. We know people are heavily affected by illegal sanctions imposed on us by USA and the Western countries. So government has always been trying to create a safer environment for our vendors. But even if we read the bylaws vendors need to be operating at designated places. This is a law that we have in the country. Yes, the issue of unemployment, we understand, and government is trying by all means to create employment. But, you know, it's a lie to say there's a convention at designated places. People, they choose not to to go and operate at designated places because they want to go where there are many people who will be traveling in CBT. So they will create a congestion, they will create a traffic jam, and this is something that you must not see purely during the time of Sadak. People need to respect you. I think that's in 1 week or 2 weeks, and then Sadak will be over, then they can come back to do their business as usual. But during this period, they need to understand that we have got an important occasion in Zimbabwe, and we cannot try to
Thank you, Mr. Tongokara. We have a caller from Harare. Hello, Mapina Mshirongo.
Hello.
Hello, yes. Triku Taranani Murku Mapinda Mshirongo. I'm not going to tinotenda munogona kutipawo pfungwa dzenyu panyaya iyi yatiri kutaura yemavhenda pakatarisirwa musangano mukuru weSADC muHarare.
Right, ini ndinoona kunge iri muvhu yakanaka kubvisa mavhenda mutown. But zvinenge zvakanaka iyo hurumende ikange yapa ivavo vairi kubvisa mutauni mabasa ekuti vararame, nekuti vakaramba vachivabvisa vasingavape mabasa ekuti vararame, vanorarama sei?
Tinotenda mukoma.
Havakwanisi kurarama kana vasina kuvapa mabasa. Vakavapa mabasa hatitodi zvenda mutauni, asi vakavapa mabasa ekuti vashande ayo zvienda zvadzake mutauni. Zvino kana pasina mabasa, chavanovadzindira vanoti vane mhuri dzinoenda chikoro, vane mhuri dzinoda kudya, ivo pachavo vanoda kudya. Zvino makavadzinga vanorarama sei? Vanhuwo vakangofanana neivava maminista, maMP vatakavhotera iva vakuru, anoenda mitemo yekuti mavhenda adzinge ivava.
Tinotenda mukoma nemashoko enyu. Vakuenda, muri vamwe vevanotengesawo muHarare, munoti kudii nemashoko aya abva kutaurwa navatongogara uyezve nevapindawo vari parunare?
Just want to agree this this recent caller just called. Because the idea is not like just to drive away or to remove street vendors from the CBD. But we should be thinking beyond just removing them. How are they going to survive? Because in a country like Zimbabwe, where a large part of the population faces here is concerning, especially related to unemployment, I don't think one should be viewing street vending as a problem. Instead, we should embrace it as a solution to mitigate the various vulnerabilities associated with poverty. We do not have jobs. We are trying to make a neutral margin. And it's very easy for someone who is in the position of authority, someone who is in a very nice office, to just suggest that I think such vendors are the problem to the upcoming public summit. I think that's not the correct way of addressing the issue. They should engage the street vendors, they should talk to us, they should also engage some organizations that represent vendors.
Thank you.
Come up with a solid plan. That is my issue, is on a solid plan to say, no, guys, we have this issue, how best can we address it? But as it is saying, it's simply the guys on top, we are just dictating what to do.
Thank you, Mr. Quendan. Unfortunately, our time is running out. We'd like to give Mr. Tongokara. We'll want to give Mr. Tongokara just a minute to respond to you. Mr. Tongokara, Quenda is saying, why should Zimbabwe view vendors as the problem, not as a solution? Because the approach points towards vendors being the problem. In a minute, kindly wrap up.
Thank you very much. No one views vendors as the problem.
but vendors regarded as entrepreneurs who are trying to survive. What we condemn sometimes is the behavior of the vendors who then create congestion, traffic jam in town. They need just to operate at designated places. Then there won't be a problem anymore. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Let me take this opportunity to thank you all for coming on the program. And that brings us to the end of our show. I would like to thank our guests, Mr. Ishe Kwenda and Mr. Snowball Tongokara. Our callers, we value you so much, and we thank you for coming on the program. We also want to thank our viewers at home. ZANU-PF linked businessmen Mike Chimombe and Moses Mpofu were today denied bail by Harare magistrate. The two are facing charges of defrauding the government of over $7.3 million in a presidential court pass-on program. Their lawyer, Ashley Mugia, speaks.
We are now coming from court. Unfortunately, our clients, that is Moses Mpofu and Mike Chimombe, were denied bail in the magistrate court. We do not agree with that judgment, but we respect it. As lawyers, we are officers of the court. Where we are disgruntled by a judgment, if you are in an inferior court, you approach another court. So our instructions from our clients were that in the case that the magistrate court denies us bail, we would appeal to the High Court. And that is precisely what we are going to do. We respect the court's judgment, but we do not agree with it. There are several issues that we think if we take it to the High Court, there is a likelihood that the High Court might side differently. We do not take these things personal. We are professionals. We do our work within the confines of the law and what is allowed in terms of the law.
What were the reasons for denying the bail?
Okay. Part of the, there are quite a number of reasons, but the court held that there were flight risks, that they were facing a serious offence, that they would likely cause public despondence and disharmony if they are released on bail. There are quite a number of reasons that were cited. But as I have said and indicated, we want to test the correctness of that judgment in the act.
That was Mike Chimombe and Moses Mpofu's lawyer, Ashley Mukia, speaking to media in Harare. High Court Judge Munamato Mtevedzi today reserved a judgment on the bail application appeal by CCC National Administrator Jameson Timber and the CCC 78. One of their lawyers, Agency Kumbo, speaks.
We have just come out of the High Court where we had come for the bail appeal hearing of Honorable Jameson Timber and 77 other appellants who were arrested and incarcerated on the 16th of June 2024. The appeal arguments proceeded well with both our lawyers and the state making arguments. The court has reserved its judgment. It was undertaken to give its judgment on the appeal on Thursday this week. So we anticipate and we expect that by Thursday, as per the court's undertaking, we are going to get a determination on the question of the appeal which we had placed before the court. And the court has indicated also that the judgment shall be handed down virtually. So that means that, you know, people will not necessarily be coming to court physically. And as soon as that judgment is out, we will make the people of Zimbabwe and the whole world know.
But are you optimistic that they will be vetted again?
Well, bail is a constitutional right. And even in the first place, we assert that all the arrested cadres were never supposed to be arrested because they did not commit no offence. They did not do anything unlawful. Gathering in Zimbabwe is a constitutional right. People have the right to associate. People have the right to organize. So, and as a result, we are hopeful that the constitution is going to be upheld. We are hopeful that the court is going to, you know, side with the constitution, side with the law of this land. Thank you very much.
That was one of the CCC lawyers, Agency Kumbo, speaking to the media outside the High Court in Harare this afternoon. Former President Donald Trump made a triumphant return to the public eye at the Republican National Convention late Monday. 2 days after he was wounded in an attempted assassination, Caroline Presutti reports from Wisconsin. Just my
children. This is Donald Trump's first public appearance since he was shot. He didn't need to speak. His state delegates filled the void. Here to join his new ballot partner, Ohio Senator J.D. Vance. It was the biggest political secret of the year, announced at the Republican National Convention.
It is therefore my honor to nominate Ohio Senator J.D. Vance for the office of Vice President of the United States of America.
Senator Vance, at age 39, brings youth to the presidential election. Known for his rural America memoir, Hillbilly Elegy, he's a former Marine and a conservative who once referred to Trump as America's Hitler. President Biden Monday called Vance a clone of Trump.
J.D. Vance be nominated by acclamation. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
The announcement comes on the first day of the Republican National Convention in front of 2,400 state delegates pledging their votes for the expected nominee, former President Donald Trump.
You're only going to interest another mess.
A few blocks from the convention, protesters against Republican policies and Trump.
Because I thought it was important to remind people that we have two candidates and one of the candidates has 34 felony counts against them.
But the Vance choice and Trump's rebound after the attempted assassination energized this group even more.
The question is not about the past. The question is about the future and how we move forward as a country and the issues impacting the American people.
These delegates say they want unity. Now, at the end of the first day of their convention, they can rally behind the full presidential ticket of Trump and Vance. Carolyn Presutti, VOA News at the Republican National Convention in Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
The Kenyan government is using a new mobile application to educate girls about menstrual health. Through the OK Kenya app, users can access information on hygiene and other topics. The goal is to dispel myths and misconceptions about menstruation and protect girls against teenage pregnancies. Victoria Amunga reports from Nairobi.
At Kenya's LVCT Health Call Center in Nairobi, workers respond to phone calls and text messages from across the country.
Have you had your periods before?
They say most of the questions are about reproductive health, especially the menstrual cycle. Menstruation is often shrouded in secrecy and shame in Kenya, according to UNICEF. The agency says teenage girls often look for information about it online, but what they find is not always accurate. To help them, the Kenyan government, UNICEF and LVCT Health created OK Kenya, a mobile app that allows teenage girls to learn about their bodies in private.
It tells them having your periods, that's a normal thing. It's not something to be ashamed of. They'll be able to know where they can get these products that they need or also support mentally, because some people don't know when they're having their periods. They will wonder, like, why am I receiving blood?
You know the attention, like, alafu.
Cecilia Loku is one of more than 8,000 people using the application. Loku, a mother of one, says her teenage pregnancy could have been avoided if she had received the information available on the app.
If I had that information, like, this app, it can predict my periods, my safe days. When I'm ovulating, I will be pregnant or I will be a mother of one right now.
According to several healthcare organizations worldwide, abstinence, refraining from all forms of sexual activity, is the only 100% effective way to avoid pregnancy. Various forms of contraception, such as using birth control pills or condoms, also greatly reduce the odds of conception.
Premenstrual syndrome, let's go to pain.
OK Kenya users can not only track their menstrual cycles on the app, but also text or call mentors and learn about reproductive health rights. Kate Kiema is Director of Programs and Impact at She's the First, a US-based girl support organization that works in Kenya and supports the app. She says innovation such as the app is needed in a society that shies away from discussing sexual and reproductive health.
Mentors are particularly shy to talk to girls about whether it's puberty or whether it's about menstrual hygiene. So you can imagine if a girl is coming from a community who think periods is such a taboo, this girl doesn't have anyone to explain to her this is a natural biological process.
An average of 4 in 10 girls in Kenya are pregnant or have had a child, according to the Ministry of Health. In a telephone interview, the ministry's deputy head, Janet Muller, said poverty and lack of education, especially in remote areas, aggravate the cases. The state established a 10-year reproductive health policy in 2022 that outlines actions to reduce teenage pregnancies, such as promoting knowledge about menstrual cycle and the use of contraception. Kenyan authorities believe tools like OK Kenya app will help teenage girls get the information they need. Victoria Amunga, VOA News, Nairobi.
Signing off in Washington, I am Chabokan Ngobe.